coffee might be okay. No special effects. Hey, good morning, everybody.
Good morning, Brent. How you doing?
Fantastic this morning. Early on the West Coast, right, Carl?
It is, yes.
Not normally residing on the West Coast, but...
No, just visiting.
Yes. Joining us here in one of the boxes today, Dr. Karl Kapp. Good to see you, sir.
Good to be here. Thanks.
And Deborah Thomas in the other square.
Hello. Glad to be here.
And of course, Chris Van Wingerden here, my partner in crime, IDIODC. Good morning, sir.
Yeah, Mark's making the Mark Shepard's making this Paul Lynn joke in the chat, which was I was going to go there too. Oh man, I think we're all drinking from the same cup of coffee this morning. Maybe
it's the first time we've had so many guests on at the same time. We're supposed to have three, but we can't really do three. So if Kevin drops in, folks, he'll probably be in the chat, and so we'll all be here. It's just Crowdcast only lets us do a couple extra videos at a time, so that's all right, though. We've just we got about 30, 45 minutes to have an interesting conversation about innovation, creativity, and play, and of course, nobody better to talk about that than these three fantastic folks. They on the front lines of this kind of stuff, actually written the book on it, no less. Carl's here today. Carl, why don't you give everybody a quick introduction?
Yeah, hi, I'm Karl Kapp. My day job is a professor of instructional technology at Bloomsburg University in Bloomsburg, Pennsylvania. And in the off hours, I like to write books, create courses, and really explore what's happening with the relationship between games, gamification, game thinking, and productivity, learning, and eventually, you know, profitability, as all organizations are seeking to do that. So I pinch myself all the time, like, am I really getting, making a living playing games? But you know what, I am, so it's been a lot of fun.
And
my mom and dad wrong, right? You're wasting
Nice.
That was my whole goal. I have this whole, like, parental.
Yeah. Right, you always got to prove the parents wrong. You and every other esports professional rolling in the dough because they're sitting in a stadium in front of, you know, 25,000 screaming teenagers rooting them on because they're playing a computer game.
Right.
You can't make money doing that.
No, you're wasting your time. Get outside, do something.
Get a real job.
In our day, that was music. You'll never make a living playing music.
Oh, they were right. Oh, and so we'll swing to the other corner in the squares, and we'll get Deborah to introduce herself and give us a little bit of background as well.
Absolutely. So I wanted to first say that I think Carl skipped the part about taking really grand vacations and weaving that into game design and game research as well, because man, those are some good blogs you've been writing, Carl, on your trip. I'm Deborah Thomas. My company is enjoying its 13th year, Silly Monkey. So I've been doing serious games for a while, and I have been doing things across the gamut. So I do card games, board games. We partner with other companies to do some 3D virtual world stuff and all sorts of things, and electronic games, you know, digital games as well. So, and as Carl said, I really love that part of my job so much. I don't always get to do things. Sometimes corporate clients will pull me in and want something creative and innovative, but then they back off. They're a little bit scared, which is why I'm glad we're talking about innovation and play today, because they'll back off and start to do something a little more traditional. But you know, I push them a little bit, so it's mm-hmm. it's fun to have this conversation today.
It's kind of funny that playing can also come with a sense of risk for many organizations.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, nobody gets fired for, you know, working 12-hour days, but if you go out, you know, play, you know, in the middle of the day, somebody sees that and it's not a good thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, even if even if that activity generates like the best idea that sells the most stuff, or, you know, solve the biggest problem or whatever, you know, it's always that little tiny seed of insight that gets planted during the very strangest of moments that leads to the big ideas, but you can never really track back to it. And we're all about, not to get off on a weird tangent, but all the stuff about data and analytics and all that kind of stuff, I think there's an element of danger going down that path too that's similar to play, and that if you start to rely on the structure too much, you forget about the amazing human potential to be pattern makers and to just come up with interesting new cool things that solve really important problems.
Yeah, exactly.
It's kind of hard to put creativity into an Excel file. Well, I have problems with those formulas anyway.
What is that formula?
It's a secret. Only the gifted have it. So, anyway.
Right.
So let's take us down the, you know, the path of thinking, you know, about play and some of the ways that lead us on here a little bit, guys, and tell us a little bit about how you start to bring that into maybe sort of a corporate world, or bringing that into helping people actually think about improving things or doing things differently, etc.
Sure. Yeah, Deborah, do you want to take it first, and then I'll take a stab?
Oh, sure. So One time, a long time ago, I did a board game for an insurance company. And so they're pretty, you know, rigid, and they didn't really want a board game. We had been creating a 5-day training project to teach new people how to run their insurance company. And at the end, they wanted a capstone event, and they wanted role-playing. And I just thought, oh my gosh, we've done so much role-playing and different things throughout the four days. So the fifth day, I really wanted to have them kind of bust out of that. So I showed them what we could do. I showed them some research that and why it could work. And this was quite a few years back. So they were really took a risk with this. And we did a day in the life, and I did incorporate role-playing, but that's... that was an example of kind of pushing them a little bit out of their boundaries. They tried it in a small, you know, pilot, and they took it nationwide after that. So, yeah, it can work. It's, if you work with them to and incorporate some of their, you know, a lot of their ideas in it, and they see that it's in there embedded, but we're still able to add some fun elements in some. Competition and game elements into it that way.
Yeah, and if you think of creativity, I always think of it as the juxtaposition of two things that don't naturally go together, right? So you take two things that don't seem to fit. You know, we had talked about before about Finding Nemo, right? So here's this fish lost in an ocean. Like, that doesn't seem to be like a really good story about a fish swimming around the ocean, right? But you take those elements and those ideas, and all of a sudden it's really kind of interesting. And the other interesting thing, if you go back to mental health issues, which is really kind of fascinating, there's a whole line of research that talks about how some of the mental health problems are because kids don't play anymore. Because everything is so structured, everything is so regimented. You have to be here for ballet, you have to be here for dance, you have to be here for music, you know, all that kind of stuff. And I think that carries on into adults. So when you see a company that's failing to innovate, that's failing to come up with new ideas, that's failing to move forward, if you go back to their work culture, some of that culture of go, 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 don't stop, nose to the grindstone, no breaks. I mean, think about, I always say, think about when the, you know, your ideas come when you're in the shower, right? So we're not gonna have like corporate showering, but we could do corporate play, which is the equivalent of distracting our minds enough to think about these creative ideas. Mm-hmm.
The space away from something like the you know, the, like you mentioned, the shower. I mean, my joke is it's the shampoo, but it's really it's the time away. It's the time to separate yourself out. And I mean, in the overnight aspect of things too, is your subconscious is sorting, you know, lots of things out, and it is drawing other connections and, like you said, connecting things that might be, you know, disparate. But yeah, I need a, sometimes I feel like I need a, you know, a waterproof notepad in the shower because you're worried that you think of something and is it going to make it past the towel and out the door?
Right. Yeah. I mean, there's that's really interesting. There was an article the other day about, I saw about how even if you're not a good, I think Kevin's about to join us, even if you're not a good drawer, someone that can sketch well, some of the really creative ideas and thoughts come from that. So sketching, drawing, coming up with those ideas. I saw like the real value of almost free drawing, right? You almost close your eyes and kind of then try to make something out of the shapes. All those kind of ideas that we've, you know, kind of abandoned when we got out of kindergarten, really turns out that we're at a loss because we've abandoned them.
And Deborah's example was an example of, I'm going to call it, let's say, structured play, because, you know, you were doing it in a formal setting with a group of people and you had given them, you know, a framework, et cetera. But we had some really, you guys were mentioning before we went on the air here today, just even some examples of non-structured play, like just getting the heck out and goofing around or whatever, in a sense. Brent, you were mentioning the story of back to the Finding Nemo, you know, the road trip that the creators of that took to simply stop on trying to, you know, force a storyline and just go out and see what kind of stuff falls into place in that way.
Yeah, I like the idea of somebody called it something different. That, like, brainstorming is all about sort of emptying out your brain and emptying out all your ideas onto one big whiteboard or whatever so that everybody can see them, or on sticky notes or whatever. But before you get to that point, there's sort of the brain filling step, right? And going out and taking in a whole bunch of really strange and odd and unique things, because that's where those weird, strange pairings come from. And, you know, how many sort of different, you know, how often do you go, you know, to strange and different places? How often do you change your routine? How often do you try something new and different? And oftentimes, those are the things that trigger something, you know, very, very different and useful.
Right. If you think about, you know, 90% of your life, you're in the same lane, right? Literally, sometimes driving to work. So how are you going to get new ideas and new concepts when everyone you talk to is in your industry? Everything you do is in your industry. I mean, even like, I used to sit on the other side of my desk sometimes in my office, and my boss was like, "What are you doing?" I'm like, "I get a little different perspective on kind of what's happening." So sometimes even little unstructured things can be really helpful. But corporations and organizations and even individuals, we get into these narrow lanes about what needs to be done. Even I even find it sometimes when I'm talking about people with games, and Deborah, I'm sure you do this, like, "Well, what game do you play?" "Well, I play, you know, Assassin's Creed all the time." "Okay, well, any other games?" "No, that's the game that I play." "Well, then you don't have that's a first person kind of shooter parkour kind of game. But what about a puzzle game like Tetris? Or what about a mystery game like Myst? Or what about a game where there's scaffolding like Plants vs. Zombies?" Like, there's lots of different things that you need to think about. And that, I think, triggers that kind of connections.
Yeah, like, I wonder how they came up with Plants versus Zombies, right? Like I'd like to hear that pitch in somebody's office, right? That's a great idea for a new game. It's going to be a smash hit on the iPad, and it's going to be about plants and zombies, because both are so popular, it's gonna work. It's gotta work. You know? Can you imagine those executives just like, "I don't know."
Right.
Sure. Looks like we do have Kevin in the chat, but and I was gonna type in a bunch of stuff, but hey, we're on video and audio, so I can say it. Kevin, we'll figure out a way here to get you on the video, perhaps in a little bit. But if you can drop your genius in the chat for now, that would be fantastic.
Angela has popped a question into the question panel. Are you working gaming concepts into the traditional meeting environment, not just for learning, for engagement purposes?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, absolutely. There's really a bunch of, you know, I always like to think, you know, people talk about gamification, which I think is an outdated term. I think game thinking is a better way to approach how games work. And a although gamification has been pretty popular. But so the idea of think about how a game works. It starts with games have challenges. Games have clear rules, but you can do lots of different things within those rules. Games have elements for engagement, and all of those things can be incorporated and have been incorporated into meetings. So, for example, sometimes I'll start a meeting with playing tic-tac-toe, right? And it's so funny, when I have people play a game of hangman or tic-tac-toe, you can just see the level of energy rising in the room. You can see the level of interaction rising in the room. So just simple games like that, just even to get people in a certain mindset, can be really helpful and can be really engaging for a meeting.
And I think people kind of did it on their own with meeting bingo.
Yeah. Yeah, if you look at how people, Deborah, I think that's a good point. If you look how people subvert, you know, authority a little bit with like meeting bingo and games, let's see how many times the boss says, huh, or or something like that, right? So, so can that kind of game be used for good? And that's what you want to, you know, kind of think about and brainstorm about. And lots of, I think, games come from initial subversion.
One time I wanted to encourage my department to let us build something I was calling Idea Central, and it was a database of, you know, good templates and ideas and things that our developers, our instructional designers could use in the training materials. And so I pitched it to my manager and then asked her if I could pitch it in a meeting. And so I thought, I'm going to do this in a whole new way. So I had someone cut out a piece of cardboard, and somebody in this one girl on my team put it on her. She was young, so I can call her girl. She's still a buddy. So she put it, and it was a long time ago. She put it around her head, and so it was cut out, and we busted in as if it was an infomercial about serious games and adding game-based elements to and through by using this database, by adding those to our training materials. And so we busted up this meeting with an important announcement, and it kind of shook things up, and they were like, what's going on? And we got their attention in a way that I think was a little better than had we just come in with a PowerPoint and tried to talk people into it.
Serious gaming requires a serious PowerPoint to support it. Stock art.
One of the things I think that we need to realize as well is games are the freedom to fail. And a lot of organizations, failure is bad. And when you take a chance with games, especially with some of the technology, it doesn't always work. And there's always that one person or two people who are quick to pounce on people whose games don't work, or who somebody decides they're not engaged, or somebody doesn't like it. There's always those naysayers out there. So you have to have a little bit of thick skin to say, you know what, I'm going to try something, and if it fails, it's okay. And what games do is they give you that layer of, oh, it's just part of the game. You know, some people win, some people lose. It's okay to fail. And that, I think, really works well in the game layer. And so that's one thing I think that companies and some people miss, is that games allow this failure, which means it allows experimentation, which means it allows you to try things. And that's a really good way to generate new ideas, innovation, and eventually get to productivity.
We even forget that so much of learning actually can come out of failing, even in a formal training program. I mean, you know, you're focused on completion and then passing, you know, the test score, but being allowing that sense of structured risk or safe risk, even with informal content, formal learning content, is a thing that we often just we don't even think about. So.
Right. And I think the game industry, people playing games more and instructional designers watching and playing themselves are starting to incorporate those nicer messages. And when somebody failed an activity, now the messages are a little more exciting and fun instead of feeling like the big red X, I just lost.
if you look at it actually from a research perspective, we find that humans learn best when they know they don't know something. So how does somebody who comes to training class know they don't know something? Well, they have to fail at something. And so part of our job as designers of instruction are to set up situations where people aren't always successful, and then they self-realize, oh, I need to focus on this, I need to do that, right? So failure is really important from a learning perspective. And if you think about, like, when you've had your best learning breakthroughs, it's usually come from some kind of failure. And you're just like, oh, I'm going to do better. And you try harder, and that makes you successful. If you are easily strolling through content, it's not going to stick with you. You're not going to be able to apply it later. In fact, there's a whole discipline called desirable difficulty. And it's a way of thinking about how to create learning from a desirable difficulty perspective. And things that the research says, things that are easy to learn in the short term are harder to recall and apply in the long term. So if you make feedback, or I mean, learning really easy, and people really get it easy, they don't necessarily have that experience. And you have to have focused, specific feedback to do that. And games do that. You have to have natural feedback. You also have to have augmented feedback. So different levels of feedback are really kind of important from that perspective. But if you think about it, it's that failure point that really triggers your desire to learn.
It it moves from extrinsic to intrinsic motivation, from thou shalt to I'm gonna, which really right. then helps solidify and pulls people through stuff. Yeah. I'm just going to, I don't know, Brent, is there anything happening in the chat? I haven't had a chance to look. So
good comments. Anything?
Cool.
Yeah, yeah, lots of good stuff. Everybody, our usual peanut gallery, which we love so much, dropping in the good comedy. So that's always good. I like to go back afterwards and keep all the good jokes. So thanks, everybody. Keep them coming.
Very cool.
Yeah, I think they're just supporting a lot of what we're talking about, for sure.
Sure. I'm just going to check and see, because maybe we should switch.
One of the things that I want to do real quick while you're looking at that and checking it out is let's look at some of the simple stuff. Like there's a lot we can talk about theoretically, and you know, I think everybody that's here we get a fun crowd of folks that like to hang out with us on Idiotic, because like you're not really that much fun if you don't enjoy the comedy of Idiotic and just our own brand and a cup of coffee and hanging out with people trying to keep things light. You know, it's kind of what we do, but what are some of those practical things, right? Like not everybody has a really big budget and a, you know, really big, you know, enterprise size company where they need to kill some budget. So they decide, hey, let's bring in a company to do some really fun games for everybody or something like that. And let's get creative and let's focus on innovation. A lot of times it's just, I got to crank out this course. I'd like to add just a little bit of something, you know, sprinkle a little bit of innovation dust on the project, or, you know, what are some of those baby steps, if at all, that instructional designers and e-learning developers can do without going to the cheesy side of things? If there is anything.
Yeah, no, there is. It's so funny. I see it would be great to Kevin to jump in on this in the chat. But there's a number of things that you can do. And I saw one question about accessibility too. I'll admit accessibility with games can be a little bit tricky because of some things, but I've seen instances where people have made pieces that are that you can touch them so that you can feel what piece is what, you know, instead of just color coding them, you can have different feels to the different pieces. But in terms of simple things to do, I always say there's a couple things. One is don't start your learning with objectives. I think objectives are horrible. They're great for design. They're horrible for a learner, right? You're going to learn three things today about whatever. And a good learner goes, I know four things. What a waste of my time. But what if you said something like, do you know the number one way that this happens in our organization? Now you've got my curiosity. Right now, I might know the number one way, I might not know. So you're adding in curiosity, which I think could be really helpful. Another thing is the element of role play or immersion. And not just like, okay, we're going to do a role play, but I've been reading a lot of the Choose Your Own Adventure books. And one of the things that they say is one of the reasons why they were so popular is because you were put in that situation. You are downed pilot in the Himalayas. What are you going to do? You make this choice. So now it brings it, makes it really personal. And that's kind of a thing that can happen as well. Also letting learners know, hey, you might not be successful at this piece of learning. It's very difficult. Let's see if you can do it, right? And then that adds that sense of challenge to it. So those are just some of the things that we can do without having to, you know, have to be all the time. You know, everybody thinks gamification is competition, points, leaderboards, that kind of stuff. But those are, I think, the least interesting elements of games. And so we can add some of these other things as well. Deborah, what's your thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, I think they are, it's the cherry picking part of games. And so it's easy to add, but they do have a value for sure, you know, if they're done correctly. But yeah, I love the adventure topics that you were just mentioned, because that's to help our learners see themselves trying to fix this widget or, you know, whatever it is that we're teaching or writing about in our courses is the best way for them to like identify with being that person who can do that. So yeah, it's a great, great thing to add.
Mm-hmm. You know what I'm going to do real quick is I'm going to tee you up, Karl, with a question about your students, because I always love to hear you talk about the projects that they do. The thing that I love to hear when I meet your students is just how practical the program is, and I'd love to hear some of the projects that you've seen them do, and if there's one in particular that you thought was really cool. I know you've recently developed a card game or something like that as well, and I know Kevin's just dropping something in, so I'm gonna drop off and okay. give a space for Kevin to jump in, and then and then, Chris, let Kevin tell a little bit about that thing and then segue into a little something special that you guys have coming in. Yep. We'll need the three of you guys talk about how you can engage with this community in a super, super fun way. And then and then just before you wrap up, bring me on back in, Chris. All right.
Perfect. So I'll drop you out, Brent, and then I'll invite Kevin in. But in the meantime, go ahead, Karl, and follow up on that thought from Brent.
Yeah, so our program does two things that are really unique in the academic community. Almost no one else does these two things. So the one is our advanced instructional design course, where our students actually go out with a client in the community and do a project from start to finish. They do the needs assessment, they write the objectives, they do a pilot test. They have to have a finished instructional design project when they're done, or they don't pass the course. So that's caused a lot of angst among students, but they have to do something start to finish. Usually it's an e-learning, but sometimes it's a stand-up instruction, and sometimes it's something like that. The other course that's really unique is our advanced instructional design, is our managing multimedia course. And in that course, I form students into teams. It's like a kind of a big game. I form students into companies, and each company is given a mock request for proposal. And they have to do a 20-minute sales presentation. They have to come up with a working prototype, and they have to write a 40-page proposal. And then when they do all that, they come to a campus for a presentation, and we invite our corporate advisory council members, alumni, and others in the field who evaluate the students' presentations. And they actually grade those presentations. And some programs will do one of these things, but few programs do both of these things. So that's kind of what makes Bloomsburg University so unique in that kind of development. And the combination of those two courses gives students kind of the sales process around writing proposals, doing sales presentations, understanding what they want. And the Corporate Advisory Council will debrief the students about, we like this, we didn't like this, this was good, this wasn't good. And the advanced ID projects will get used in lots of different places. We did one for a box called ATC 600A, our students did years ago. And that's a flight box to test the radio on an airplane. And they actually were invited because of that down to the aviation conference and presented their project, instructional design project, at the aviation conference. So I thought that was pretty cool.
Very, yeah. Very cool. Kevin, you were mentioning, we have Kevin with us now.
Hey, what's going on? Can y'all hear me okay?
Yeah, you're rocking it.
Okay.
You're rocking it. You were mentioning in the chat there, Kevin, about the comic book that you were talking about with the two different perspectives. And we thought, hey, let's bring Kevin in and have him elaborate on that a little bit, because that's a that was a really neat idea.
Oh, just the instructional comic and choose your own adventure. Yeah, I've been doing instructional comics for a couple years now, but more on the serious level. And gaming and trying to put gaming into it, that's a huge effort, trying to do a story and a game and a comic all at the same time. I don't have a team that big to film something like that just yet. But yeah, it's we were at a difficult target audience that is very literal in terms of language, low literacy. So this is where comic, instructional comics come in really, really powerful, especially when you have an audience that's low literacy. Because you tell you tell your images and you tell your story through images. There's a great book called Drawing Pictures and or Drawing Words and Writing Pictures, and it talks about how you do sequential storytelling. But then from an instructional standpoint, then you bring in all your instructional design just like you would normally do, but you're telling it through visuals and through storytelling. And then you can, once you get that structure, that framework in place, not counting all the artwork, character development, all the other normal stuff you would typically do in like designing a comic story. But then once you get all those pieces in, then you can lay on top, like Carl was thinking, you can lay on a choose-your-own-adventure on top of that. You can lay in a sort of some gaming elements on top of that. You kind of layer that in depending on the depth of seriousness or the depth of engagement you want to do. So what we did is, we had an antagonist and a protagonist that who started out as it was part of nursing, and they were both in nursing school together. And when they went through their first sort of clinic rotations and training, one nurse had really great experiences, was treated well, had a lot of encouragement, like we're talking about being able to fail in a safe place, things like that, and really got motivated and became really good at her role as a nurse. The other one, on the other hand, had a completely opposite experience. Was always treated badly, negative, always, you know, berated and criticized and condemned for mistakes. So at the end, one decided to take the path that I'm going to teach everybody how to be, you know, like I was treated. I'm going to bring everybody up the way I was treated. And the other one's like, I'm going to totally destroy this because this is fake. Nobody's, you know, they're selling you garbage. And by the time you get in here, they promise you all this stuff, but it's all fake. So now they become rivals to try to accomplish the same thing. So you pick one of the characters and then you get a perspective of whether you go down the bad path and get treated horribly or you get good experiences. And then in the end, the idea is coming back together. So we've got two episodes out and it's funded by the Gates Foundation. So we just got excited that they just funded two more episodes. So we're going to build two more. And I just heard too that they want it completely translated in Hindi and one printed version as well. So we're going to do a printed version of the first episode. So we got a lot of artwork to do coming up.
No kidding. Russell's tossed a question in the panel here. And how do you add all this cool gaming and gamification in e-learning while still meeting accessibility requirements? Any recommendations? And that may not be something that we can do within our too much on within our time frame here today. But I think some of the things aren't necessarily technologically driven. I mean, even tone of voice, in you know, using more of a storytelling voice. Well, you can still work with text, and it's very accessible. But you know, that introduces some of this sense of you know, play or gamification. And simple things like that that don't necessarily need to, you know, require a lot of, let's call it accessible technology tweaking.
Yeah, well, there was a really interesting article a while back about a gentleman. He was blind, and he played this one video game because the audio was so good. Mm. So sometimes if we forget about the audio, like the different voices and different characters, that kind of stuff, if you think about designing for screen readers, sometimes that can help. If you think about early MUDs, right? Dungeon play, where really you had to type in turn left, and then somebody else would turn it, and on the left you see a treasure chest. So you can take some of what you're doing with like the multimedia and make a text version and run the text version through a screen reader, and you can add a lot of elements that way as well. So it's not impossible to do. It definitely can be using those elements to enhance the learning perspective. And then physical objects, you know, you make them different sizes, make different cards for different things, different sizes. You could add Braille. There's a lot of different things that can be done depending on, again, comes back to your budget, time, you know, the number of people you're reaching, that kind of stuff.
I would add, too, that when you talk about audio sound effects, take a careful study and actually have a sound effect, just like you would source your images for a particular course. Sound effects are really critical a lot of times, because those sound effects and the volume and the tone of those effects can make a difference.
Mm-hmm. We forget how much, in the case of games and movies, et cetera, how much the sound actually contributes to the realism of what's going on. It's not just that people are moving across the screen or something. It works at the sort of background level, but it really creates the, you know, the mood, the tone, draws us in, and all those sorts of things. Yeah. We've had an awesome chat. We're kind of running up towards the end of our time. The reason why the three of you are here together is that you guys actually have something going on to help people kind of explore this world a little bit more and maybe roll up their sleeves and dig in a bit more. So tell us a bit about that.
Great. We've gotten together and we've found a house in Florida where every room is themed after a different game. Scrabble, Monopoly, Stratego, there's a Lego room, and we're conducting a week-long step away session. So, you know, we talked about how innovation comes when you step away from the normal and do some things that are a little bit different and juxtapose things that don't go together. That's what we're doing at this place. There's a Minecraft room here. I don't know if there's a D&D room. I'm not sure. We can definitely, maybe we could create one if you couple decorate the one of them. But the cool thing about this is really we're focused on the linkage between creativity, innovation, productivity. So it's not just come play games for a week. It's structured time, but also unstructured time. And I'll let Kevin and Deborah talk a little bit about what, some of the ideas that we have for the week.
Well, one of the things we're going to do is start off with teaching people game design, game mechanics, and game theory, but really briefly, just overall overview, and then get right to work on building a game, because by the end of the week, you will have a card game that will be created and built by you. And with Kevin's artistic skills, designing the art for it, then it'll be mailed to you when you get home after it's, you know, printed and published. You'll get this box in the mail. And we have a game around that as well. So we have a lot of surprises with this event. But that's one of the things. And then Kevin, you can talk about the comic book that we're going to design and build during this event as well.
Yeah. So the whole idea is, a lot of times when you do, you know, workshops at conferences and things like that, you get all these great concepts. You make it your hands on a little bit. But then when you get back to your organization, you're left with, oh my gosh, I got to do this by myself now. And it just takes so much more energy. And you might fail, you might succeed, or you might not get exactly what you want out of it. So the goal here is to spend a week together. We kick things off with, like Deborah said, we just start talking about game design and game thinking, and then we get right to busy and we start designing a game, a card game. And then throughout the week, there's so many unstructured, like Carl mentioned, unstructured events and activities. And, you know, it's a game house, so you're not going to be bored at all the whole week. But then we get into storytelling, and we talk about storytelling as it applies to game. And what's your story? What's your theme? And then we work through actually designing a story and crafting it and what you have to consider and go through and build that. And then as we get farther along, we talk about how do we, when we talk about telling stories metaphorically, and then we're going to use Lego Serious Play. We actually play Lego and we'll pose some really complex, challenging questions. And then you have to actually answer that question by building a model out of Lego. And that's going to help your brain get into that, okay, now I'm into that really, really deep design sort of thinking mode. And then we're going to switch back over and get back into game design. And then we go through the art process. How do you design art for a card game? What does that look like? How do you design the card back? What does it look like? How do you design the art for the card box? What's the process? So exactly, it's soup to nuts. You get there Sunday night, we'll have a little party, you know, to welcome everybody.
And games that day games, as well. Yep.
Oh, we're playing games all week long.
Games.
It's all inclusive, which is really cool. So all the meals, everything is covered. You get full three hots and a cot, as they say.
And of course, the coffee.
Right.
I'll be there. I'll be there for sure too. Yeah, Brent's thrown a link to the project in the chat. So if anybody's interested, guys, just click on the link and you can learn more. It's going to be really very cool, and we're actually looking forward to finding out some of the things that you guys discovered along the way as maybe as a follow up and see, yeah, maybe bring it, or maybe we can even think about a couple of attendees or something and get that perspective too, because this is it's a really neat idea. It's such an inversion or almost an apposite of a conference.
Yeah, it's like fun event or something.
Yeah.
I don't want to add to it.
You know, we've all been to conferences, we've all presented at conferences, which is great. You get a good breadth, but not the depth.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you can, you know, sit at the table and breakfast and, you know, pick Kevin and Deborah's brains about, you know, comics or games or whatever. So it was just, you know, it came a little bit, you know, people come up after us when we present asking questions, and we can, you know, give a cursory answer, but, you know, there's, you know, other people in line, but this gives us and the attendees a chance to sit down and really talk with us about what their issues are, what they're trying to do, how they're trying to bring in creativity, how they want to draw, you know, how they want to create. So I think it's really kind of a conference that I'd like to go to. And so we sat down and said, you know, what kind of conference could we develop to do this? And you know, this is this is the idea. So we're really excited about it. We've got lots of interest in it. Lots of people already. You know, there's only 20 slots, so slots are going really quickly. So if you are interested, you might want to act, you know, sooner rather than later. And I think Kevin, don't we have a code?
Oh, yeah. My code is IDI. I'm putting it in chat. That's the code. It's simply IDIODC.
Of course, right.
Yeah, that's the code.
And that gets you a discount.
It gets you a discount.
Yeah, so.
I did want to add, but rooms are, the rooms are themed after board games. So if you go to the website, stepaway.design, and you can see all the rooms, and there's Clue and Stratego and Monopoly and the Xbox video game room is pretty slick because you get a TV and a game console on your bed.
Right. So,
but what's really cool is each one of the rooms are actually games. So yeah. Like the Ms. Pac-Man room, you actually get the actual arcade, the classic arcade Ms. Pac-Man in your own room. So if ever, you know, you can have a party in your room, say, hey, everybody come play Ms. Pac-Man, or you can lock the door and say, no, I'm doing a marathon run all night because I've played this 20 years. But the Clue and Stratego room, they're actually escape rooms. There's a laser room that you have to solve a puzzle before you can get in bed, or you kind of get zapped, figuratively, literally speaking. So yeah, each one of the Lego room is actually giant foam Lego bricks that you just pile through to get to your bed. So it's really going to be a blast.
Very cool. Very cool.
Every bedroom has a bathroom. I think that's what Jonathan was asking. Every room has its own bathroom.
Yeah, except just in case.
Except the dungeon, Minecraft dungeon. I don't think that has a bathroom. It's under the stairs.
That seems appropriate. Cool. So the idiotic code today, guys. If anybody's interested in joining, get you a bit of a discount, and that's pretty awesome. Idiotic. It's not just coffee and conversation. It's also good value. That's our new motto. Excellent. Guys, thanks so much for joining us here today. This has been awesome, very inspirational, and I have a funny feeling that we're all going to end up playing Dungeons & Dragons for the rest of the day here. I know that's my plan, but just don't tell my boss that. I'll pretend to work. So, awesome. Guys, thanks so much. Actually, I'm going to bring Brent back in only because Brent's got the music. So I'll drop Kevin. I'm going to drop you out. I'm going to bring Brent back in so that we can at least dance because, you know, that's our – Our fun. Where did Brent go on the list? What page am I on now?
We lost him.
No, I just can't find him. There he is. We'll bring Brent back in for the music. I never thought to have it queued up myself.
I totally forgot about that.
Yeah. So this is our play.
I totally wish I could take a whole week and get out there and be a part of that event. I'm super excited about that. We'll see. We'll see. Still working on it. We'll hope everybody had a great conversation today. Hope you guys had a great time. And you know what? Guess it is time to dance.
There it is. Thanks, gang, for joining us. Thanks to our amazing guests, but thanks to our amazing audience, too. Check out that Step Away Design link, and we'll catch up with you guys later.
Thank you.
Yep. And Russell, sorry we didn't get to your accessibility question. Hit us up afterwards on Twitter. Maybe we can make that a question of the day or something, and we'll talk about accessibility of games. That would
be touched on it a little bit. It was It's a good question.
Yeah, it's a deep dive. Yeah.
For sure. All right, everybody. We'll talk to you. The last special effect of the day. The epic zoom. Which company do I get?